The first question I have is, can you please tell us your name and your profession?
My name is Peter Simmons. I've been an academic all of my employed life, and with me is my wife, Ruth.
Hello, I'm Ruth Simmons.
Another academic.
And can you please tell us your relationships to Ohio State University?
I was professor of law, and I also taught in the Department of Urban Planning between 1967 and 1975, when we moved to New Jersey, where I became dean and professor of law at the Rutgers Law School.
And Mrs. Simmons?
I was a part-time instructor at Ohio State in the College of Education for 7 years. And I taught part-time school and society courses like that. And I have a second profession, and that is as an archivist and manuscript curator, which I then transferred to. And that's what I did for most of my professional life.
But tell them about the course you originated and taught at OSU.
After, I thought, why don't we do that later?
Okay, whatever you say.
Okay. Mr. Simmons, can you tell us what Ohio State was like, what Columbus was like in 1971?
Is that addressed to me or to Ruth?
To you, and specifically the political and social landscape.
The slogan most familiar was, "When will Columbus discover America?" It was a quiet, middle-sized town. We lived in a lovely residential area known as Old Beechwald. The campus was a very friendly place, at least for white faculty. There were lots of good colleagues, lots of interesting students. So I look back upon it very fondly, in spite of the fact that there were some bad scenes while we were there.
And when you say bad scenes, what do you mean?
Well, the Black student organization was pushed to point of desperation, where it took over the administration building to try to secure decent treatment on campus and to urge the founding of a Black Studies department. It was somewhat parochial. It was somewhat out of the mainstream compared with living in the New York metropolitan area, as we have for the last 40 some odd years.
I see. And in general, was there a lot of unrest on campus?
I wouldn't say there was a lot. However, this was the years of the draft and Kent State, and there was a substantial amount of student and faculty activism on campus, as I recall.
Well, there was a the state troops were called in, and the Ohio State University was shut down for 10 days. Faculty members couldn't go to their departments and so forth. It was quite chaotic.
That explains why there were no students in my classes.
Mrs. Simmons, can you say a little bit more about what precipitated the shutdown of OSU?
Well, I think it started with Kent State, and because once Kent State occurred and the students were killed, this spread across the country, and Ohio State was not immune to that pressure. So the Black students became much more active, but there were also anti-war, anti-Vietnam protests at the same time. However, there was a point in time when the Black students took over the administration building and demanded that there be change. And when they got into the administration building, they called Peter and they said, okay, Peter, what do we do now? And Peter said—
They were not that informally, always called me Professor Simmons.
Professor Simmons, what do we do now? And Professor Simmons said, what do you want? And they made their list, including a Black Studies department, and presented the list to the university, and there was some negotiating. And there was established a Black Studies department, and Charlie Ross was hired as director.
I see, and prior to being hired as the director, he was a faculty member?
Not that I recall. I believe he came for that particular position.
I see. And so do you have a memory of having met him? And if not, can you tell us how you came to represent him?
Unfortunately, I don't remember how I met him. I don't have a specific memory on how I came to represent him. My hunch is that he knew my name and he knew I was at the law school, so he came over and asked for help, but I don't recall that specifically.
I see. And Mrs. Simmons, do you have any memory of Charles Ross starting as the director of the Black Studies Department?
No, I don't. I may have met him once or twice, but I did not, I do not have any memory of being involved with his predicament.
Okay. Well, Mr. Simmons, can you talk about your, before we get to the case itself, can you talk about your memories of Charles Ross as a person and any awareness that you may have had of him as an activist in Columbus?
I don't have specific memories of him as, quote, a person, close quote. We did not have a social relationship. It was largely a professional one where I represented him. And I don't believe that we had much contact after the hearing was over. We may have, but I just don't recall.
Okay, so can you talk about the hearing itself, the HB 1219 hearing that Charles Ross had?
The hearing was held in a state office building in downtown Columbus. I assume it was in the state capitol. I remember showing up in the morning and there was a hearing officer, and I don't recall who else, but the room had a number of observers. I was a little bit nervous because Bill Kunstler wasn't there and he was supposed to do much of the argument. He was a professional at argumentation. However, I began and presented the argument based on the statute recently adopted by the Ohio legislature and explained why I didn't think that Charles Ross's behavior fell under the statute, because what he was accused of doing was at a local high school, and the statute regulated conduct by faculty members on the campus. Not being on the campus, I argued that the statute didn't cover him and we ought to all go home.
And how was your argument received?
I'll let you guess at that. Not very well. And I don't have a very vigorous or firm memory of what happened next. I know I spoke for a while, and then Bill Kunstler arrived, and made a grand entrance. He was very theatrical. And then he took over the hearing and spoke about the broader implications of the charge against a Black faculty member for doing nothing more than appearing at a high school to which he'd been invited by students. But I don't remember much else about the hearing other than it took much of the morning and Ruth was not there.
No, I was not there, but tell them how you got Kunstler to come, because Kunstler was very famous and had many requests for his work.
Well, he was a nationally known or internationally known civil rights lawyer. And when Charles was charged, I realized that this was something above and beyond my capability. So I got on the telephone and I called Kunstler's office. And a young man answered the phone, one of his associates. And I explained why I called. And he said, okay, we'll call you back. And soon thereafter, I got a call back from this young man who said, Attorney Kunstler will come. And that was how he came. He agreed to help out.
Were you surprised that he agreed to come?
Not totally, because he had a reputation of being very helpful and giving himself without compensation to situations of this sort where people needed him, and particularly where Blacks were being mistreated.
And so I guess that leads to my next question. Did you feel that the proceedings against Charles Ross were fair? Why or why not?
Well, I thought they were absurd, because if you look at the statute, it makes very clear that the legislature was concerned with conduct at and on university campuses. And Ross was charged with misbehavior at a local high school, probably 5 miles from the campus. So I thought that was absurd. The conduct of the hearing officer and the staff was polite and very professional. I have no other recollection than that, other than that when Kunstler showed up, he took over the hearing. He was a very dramatic and experienced speaker. And anytime he went to a meeting, he took over the meeting. He was very, very dramatic, and you couldn't help but focus all your attention on him.
Interesting. That's exactly what I would have expected, actually. It's funny, my dad was a criminal and civil attorney, and he definitely was a fan of Kunstler. I do remember that. So anyway, was there anything that either of you wanted to add? Any other thoughts that you had? Anything that you feel that we should know or that the audience would want to know or be interested in?
Ruth, you want to say something? Okay. My recollection is that Ohio State was a very mixed institution. It had a long history of educating Black PhDs in education and some other fields. So it was a place that Black students came to from all over the South. Other than that, it was Columbus, Ohio, which was football, football, and football, things that I was not particularly interested in. But we enjoy, at least my recollections of Columbus and the campus are very favorable, except for one or two instances where I think the administration behaved abominably. The faculty basically were decent, intelligent, hardworking people. There were decent administrators, but the upper echelon of the administration were old-fashioned and somewhat nasty in their treatment of students, both Black and white, and particularly Black students. They had no empathy whatsoever about the Black revolution that was occurring in the country. You want to add something?
Well, I think that there was the OSU 34. These were the students who had taken over the administration building and had made the demands that were mentioned before. And they brought charges against these 34 students who, and for what were the, what was the?
They brought them in a civil court and criminal court in downtown Columbus, charged them with kidnapping, because when they took over the administration building, they held meetings with administrators, and the administrators claimed they were held there by force. There was certainly no evidence of that, but that's the way Columbus behaved in those days. It was a hostile place for Black people.
Well, so after they took over the administration building and they were negotiating, someone at the university, one of the upper administrators, sent around a piece of paper saying, why don't you put your names and addresses on this piece of paper, and then we'll know who's here, and
grant you excuses for missing class.
Excuses for missing class. Well, of course, what they did was they took the names of the students and they brought an action against them in court, as Peter just
said.
They were indicted. Well, one of the interesting things that happened was these students were all uniformly top students. They were excellent students. They had a tremendous amount of service experience. They were leading members of their community, their and so on. So when it came time to question the students, they brought their high school teachers, their elementary teachers, their ministers, the leaders of their communities, and they simply overwhelmed in good behavior and thoughtfulness.
Wow. I had no idea of any of that. Thank you for sharing that. And so, Mrs. Simmons, did you want to talk about your experience at OSU in the class that you?
There's one. I had been working on a syllabus for a Black history course, particularly Black education in a broad sense, starting with this the enslaved experience, et cetera. And I worked up a course outline and a bibliography and goals to be met, et cetera. And I had given it to someone in the College of Education to raise as a possibility. And so when the Black students took over the administration building and made their demands, someone said, wait a minute, there's this course syllabus that some woman put out. Where is that course syllabus? And within 6 weeks, the course was through all of the faculty and university committees and was on the books for the fall. And so, I taught that course for 7 years, but I was just a part-time teacher. However, the course was about a third of the class every year took the course. So there were a substantial number of Black students who did take the course. The most interesting one, the most famous student was Jack Tatum, the football player who took the course. He was a good student. He got a good grade.
Oh, wow. And what year was that?
Well, I'm trying to remember the year. It was fairly soon after we arrived. We arrived at Ohio State at 67.
Yes.
Yeah, so it was the following year, the course, so 68.
Gotcha.
Tatum wrote an autobiography.
Called The Assassin, about his...
They call me the assassin.
They call me the assassin.
Yeah.
He
played pro ball.
I didn't know who he was at the time. Students came up after class and said, "Do you know who that man is?" I said, "No." And I said, "It's a new student for the class." And then someone said, "Well, that's Jack Tatum." And I said, "Oh, who is Jack Tatum?" I didn't follow football. And they told me about him. And so I was aware of his presence in the class. He didn't participate much, but he did very well on the exams.
So let me ask you then, and just in general, how was the class received? I mean, I assume it must have been received well if you taught it for 7 years.
It was received very well. As I say, a third of the students were always African-American students. And so that made them a lively class discussion. It was focused on discussion and certain readings. There were the scholarship at the time was very rich, and I could be as broad as I wanted, not only talking about the repression of teaching enslaved people to read or write, it was illegal in much of the South, as well as into the Harlem Renaissance. I mean, I could be as broad, and the students were very responsive.
Wow.
But when I left, that was it.
I see. That was actually going to be my next question, so thank you.